ball with socks.
Clothes.
A pencil.
A little small stuffed animal.
I don't really think I got a bad Christmas gift ever. I think I've gotten everything I really wanted.
The worst Christmas present I've ever got is probably a blue robot, because it runs out of battery like 3 days it's out of battery.
You like forgiveness or?
Gold, silver, and clothes.
Gold, silver,
myrrh, gold, Frankenstein.
Gold, boysenberry,
whiskey.
Gold and murder.
Bethlehem.
Bethlehem?
Dallas?
I think Jesus did.
Joseph.
Gabriel the angel came and told her.
'Cause there was an angel that told her.
I think God told her.
An angel.
The spirits told her.
Like in Pocahontas?
George.
King Arthur.
Goliath.
Henry. Joshua.
Bethlehem.
Herod.
Come and see God's
Well, they're absolutely wonderful, aren't they? Good job, kids. Thank you. It was so fun. And it's really nice that you all chose to sit right down front to hear the sermon today. I really appreciate that. Is that, you want me to smile at that camera? Is that, okay, I'll get out of the way here. And let's do thank our workers for all that they do for our children. They do a fabulous job. So we thank you. A couple of the grandsons in there I thought were the most spectacular of all of them, by the way. They're good, but we do appreciate you. We appreciate all the kids and kids ministry. I want you to know that on the average weekend, this is just the pre-K and CRE group, and the average weekend we have around 500 kids down in the other end and celebrating here, and the wonderful thing that this church has. So we appreciate them and all that the children's ministry does. Christmas carols are fun. The song they just sang, the one that We Wish You Merry Christmas, is around from the 16th century. It's an old one. There's one that's even older. The old Come, O Come, Emmanuel was penned in the 9th century. And so what we're going to do today is we're going to take a look at a Christmas song. Christmas songs have been part of Christmas for a long time. We're going to look at the very first Christmas song, and we're going to see it done in the first century. There's all kinds of Christmas songs we love, come together, and we honor, and we remember. And some of those songs have changed over the time. One of them we get totally wrong. We sing Jingle Bells. You all know Jingle Bells? We do that totally wrong because it's actually written as a Thanksgiving song. Now you've had it. You've been doing it wrong all this time. I feel kind of depleted. Another one actually had a different name. We know the song Silver Bells. That's not the original title. The original title was Tinkle Bells. And after they wrote it, performed it, the wife of Livingston, who one of the authors, came up and said, you know, you really should change the name because tinkle means actually something else too. So they changed the name, and you're glad they did. We sing all these songs about Jesus. There's the secular Christmas songs. They're all fun. It amazes me when we watch Christmas movies, which we love watching Christmas movies. They all have the very same plot, but they're fun to watch anyway. We watch the Christmas movies, and they come together, and it's just interesting because there's nothing about Jesus through the whole movie, and then still they use those songs. And one we watched recently, it was the romantic part of the song where they're doing their Christmas dance. It's a slow dance, and the song that comes on is Silent Night. That's the romantic song, and I think, do you hear what you're singing about Jesus is born, but there's no acknowledgement of it? Another one we watched had the town Christmas lighting where they come and watch the Christmas tree being lit. I've never been to one of those in my life, but it seems like on TV every town has one of those all tree Christmas lightings. They come in and they're all standing around and they all are singing Noel, 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 born is the King of Israel. So if they're acknowledging, they're singing it, but they don't even realize what they're singing. And sometimes we do the same thing, isn't it? True? We'll sing these songs, or we just did a couple of songs. We call it our worship time earlier. We're singing those words. We're expressing it. We're saying it. But do we really resonate in our heart with what we're saying? Do we really believe the truth of this? And if so, how do we live it out? A lot of people say Merry Christmas. We talk about Christmas. We celebrate Christmas. Obviously, in the word Christmas is the word Christ. Christ is the Greek title of Messiah. When it's translated from Greek into, or from Greek into, or from Hebrew word Messiah into Greek, it went from Messiah to Christos, which is Christ. But every time we say Christmas, we're acknowledging the Messiah has come from heaven for each one of us. The Messiah, Jesus, is the fulfillment of it. Christmas songs always been around. Again, that very first Christmas, we see Mary singing the very first Christmas song. Zechariah did, actually before Jesus was born. The angels sang at his birth. And then we see Simeon, the old prophet, singing there on when Jesus is just days old. But the singing was around. It was an expression of their heart. What we're going to do is we want to take a look in Luke chapter 1 of the very first Christmas song that Mary sang. And we're going to pull the truths. Some truths from the words of this song and realize what Christmas worship is about. It's an expression of what God is doing in our hearts and who God is. So if you open your Bibles, let's go back first in chapter 1. Verse 37 was when the angel came and Tacoma shared with us last week how this birth was foretold. The angel says to her in Luke chapter 1, verse 37, all that the Messiah is going to do. And then he says, for nothing is impossible with God. that God can and will do his will no matter what. And then going on, nothing's impossible with God. Verse 38, I am the Lord's servant, Mary answered. May it be to me as you have said. And then the angel left her. Her response was, this is what's going to be. We're going to do it. This word servant, we're going to see it here. We'll see it another time as part of her song. The word servant, when she says that, literally that is the word slave. She says, I am the Lord's slave. It's a strong emphasis of what we would call servant, saying, I will do whatever God wants. That's a humble disciple before him, a humble follower. It's, I'll do whatever God asks me to do. The verses that following says, Mary got up and then she went down to see her cousin, Elizabeth and Zechariah. We looked at that message or that story a couple weeks ago. So when she goes down there, she travels a long ways. It says it was in the hill country around Judea, which is down in Jerusalem. So she travels from Nazareth in the north all the way down to the south. There's two different traditions. One is it was in Karim, was where she was at, just 4 miles west of Jerusalem. And there's a place there that honors that. Another tradition teaches that it was actually in Hebron, which is even further south. But regardless, she travels around 80 miles, give or take. It takes her several days, but she gets there. And when she goes into the house of Zechariah and Elizabeth, Elizabeth recognizes right off. Of course, she knows who she is. But she realizes that Mary is pregnant with the coming Messiah. And so Elizabeth gives her a blessing. And then Mary's response was a song of worship. It just came out. It was a part of who she is. So there's some things we want to recognize at Christmas time. How do we respond with what God is doing in our life? And certainly at the time of Christmas. And one of those right off the bat is looking at Christmas, we recognize God's greatness. We just recognize God and who he is. In his power and his strength and what he has to give to each one of us. Now, Mary did not sing to experience worship, and sometimes we think we come to church and they need to do the right kind of music, the right song, the right setting, and then I can worship, and if they don't do it just right, then I can't worship. But that's not at all biblical. That's not a biblical stance at all. Worship is an expression of our heart, and music is one of those opportunities by which we express worship. But the song just came out of her and who she is. So verse 46, we start looking at the song. It says, and Mary said, my soul glorifies the Lord. Now some of your versions say this. It says, my soul magnifies the Lord. The word glorifies, magnifies, is the Greek word megaluno. That was translated into Latin, magnificat. And so some of you come from a church background that call this the magnificat. And that's where it comes from, the Latin. So it's Mary's glorification of Jesus, or how she glorifies, or how she magnifies. So it says she magnifies the Lord. She doesn't need to make him bigger than he already is, but in her eyes, in the eyes of people around, she wants to lift up the name of Jesus. Part of our worship is we want to magnify God's presence and his prominence in each of our hearts and each of our lives, and that's what she does. So she begins her song by saying, I want to glorify God for who he is. Let's go on. Verse 46, Mary says, my soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. Let's just pause a minute there. She says, my Savior. Mary needed a Savior. You don't need a Savior unless you're sinful. And so Mary recognized in her humble state that she was a sinner, and she needed a Savior just like you and I do. And so there's some traditions teach she didn't need that, but the Bible, by her own very words, she does need a Savior. And she's so grateful that the Messiah is coming, that God is going to use her as part of that process, and that her Savior is going to come, and for that she magnifies God. Now here's Mary, this unwed teen girl, very young. She's engaged to be married. She isn't married yet, and God is going to work in her life. And by the law of that day, an unwed teenager or a person who's caught in the act of adultery outside of marriage was capital punishment. It was death. It was stoning. So she has no clue what her future is going to be by the world standards. Certainly in that very small town, there was going to be a lot of shame put on her by the people around her, by her family, by her friends, by the expectations around. So she could have been worried, fearsome, what's going on, what's going to happen? But instead, in her heart, it was God is doing something great. And he's bringing the Savior. And so she had a very uncertain future in front of her. But even in spite of that, she was able to worship and honor God. And some of you here today have a very uncertain future. You're not sure what tomorrow holds. You're not sure what's going to come. Maybe you receive some news, some difficulty, and there's some hardships going on, and there's just uncertainty. But in the midst of uncertainty, can we follow Mary's example and say, God, you are still great, and I'm still going to worship you and honor you for being the great God you are. Even though I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow, I know your power, and you're in me, and you're going to be working through it. Another thing we'll look at is at Christmas time, we need to be reminded of humility. Just humility and what that means. We see Mary demonstrating it, saying it so over and over. Humility is such a strong part of the Christmas story and certainly of this song. Verse 48, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the mighty one has done great things for me. Holy is his name. So she's recognizing God is there. And again, she used that word servant. Here's the humble state of a servant. She's literally saying, God, you recognize the humble state of your slave. I'm a nobody. I'm at the bottom of the rung. As Nokomis pointed out last week, she was from a very poor town, a very poor family. She didn't have much at all. And she could say, God, of all the thousands of young people out there, all the thousands of women, you could have chose anyone. Of all the thousands of poor people, poor women, you could have chose anyone. But God, you chose me. And she's overwhelmed. She doesn't see herself as high and mighty, lifted up. Look how important I am. But she still sees herself in a very humble state. And she sees herself as a slave that I will do whatever you ask me to do, God. And she's saying, even in this state, she recognizes that she's going to be the one to bring the Messiah into the world, that people are going to call her blessed. But in her eyes, she was just a servant of God. Some traditions lift up the holy name of Mary, but that's not how she sees it. Mary says it's holy as his name. Holy is the name of the Messiah, not her. So we see this humility demonstrated in a strong way. I believe humility is a trait of someone who has spent enough time as a follower of God that they understand his greatness and they understand their need for him in their life. They understand their sin. And as well as you need to spend time with God, recognize who he is and who you are and how those two come together. And when the result comes, you realize I deserve hell, but he gives me grace and we are grateful to him. Humility should not be something that we struggle with as a follower of God when we recognize who he is in our life. But as human beings, it's something that often is a struggle for us. Something we see in Peter in the book of Luke chapter 5 verse 8, after he first saw Jesus and he saw him in a great miracle that he did with those fish, it says that Peter got out of the boat, went over to him, and he literally fell on his knees in front of Jesus and he said, you must depart from me for I am a sinful man. When he saw truly how great and powerful God is, he saw himself in his weakness and his sin, and his result was, he was so unworthy to be in the presence of God. Sometimes as American Christians, we see Jesus as our buddy, old pal, everything's good, hanging out. Hey, it's all good, no problems here. And we forget who we are and who he is. Recognizing God loves you, but also recognizing our need for him. The Christmas story is filled with God using humble people. 2 weeks ago, we looked at Zechariah and Elizabeth. Very unlikely people, but God chose them. We see him choosing Mary and Joseph. Again, two very unlikely people. We're going to see him using shepherds, people that were cast out. We see him using this old prophet hanging out in the temple and this older lady, Anna, and saying God comes in and he chooses people that the world often overlooks, but they are humble before him and they're in a place where they can be blessed. What we don't see in the Christmas story, we don't see these highly important spiritual people of the day, spiritual religious leaders. We don't see any politicians represented in the Bible that were so important in moving laws. We don't see any incredibly wealthy people doing some great things or people with huge titles in that Christmas story. We just see humble, simple people before God. And that gives me hope that God chooses and works through all of us. We see God blesses people who see their need of him. People just see, I need God in my life. I need him. I need the direction there. Now, you know, you can't become a follower of Jesus without some humility. Because you got to be able to come to him and say, I need you, God. I need your help. I need your strength. I need you working in my life. You got to start on your knees before God as a beginning follower of Jesus. And we stay there recognizing him and who he is. We continue to grow in him. So God is the center of my life, and I'm walking with him. One of the old desert monks who's written much to inspire so many is St. Francis of Assisi. And he said, if God can use me, God can use anyone. That's a humble attitude. So if God can use me, God can use anybody out there. Not look how great and wonderful I am. Look at all that I have to accomplish. Let's go down to verse 51. It says, he has performed mighty deeds with his arm. God has. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. So he has scattered those. When we have this pride in our mind that says, look how important I am. Look at all that I've accomplished. Look at my titles. Look at my house. Look at all this stuff that I've accomplished. We know that that could be gone in a moment's time. One disaster comes, one illness comes, and it could all be over with so quick. And when our pride is in those stuff, when it's gone, then who are we? Then where are we at with God? It says he can take down those from their thrones who are proud in their inmost thoughts. God's taking care of all the Herods and the Caesars and the Hitlers, and sure, they rule for a while, and they can swath a path that's harsh. But when it's all done and over with, where do they stand before God? He says, he has lifted up the humble. He recognizes there. Sometimes we go in this path that we're actually going after just like those other guys do. We want to acquire the most, become the most important, and we'll knock down everybody around. But instead of choosing that path, we need to choose the path that God has laid out for us. That's just humility before him. When I was a kid, we used to play a game called King of the Hill. Now, King of the Hill, I'm not referring to that TV show, all right? That's not it at all. But the King of the Hill was just this fun game, and on the farm we did a lot. When you stack up the hay bales and you get on top, and you were the king of that hill. And the goal was to get that person off. It didn't matter how you got him off: throw, hit, kick, scramble, pull, jerk. And it was just a tug and war to see who's on the top. If you stayed on top, it was fun. We'd do it with a big pile of dirt. My cousin, they dug a basement for a new house, and so it was a huge pile of dirt, and it was the best place to do it. And there was a lot of pushing, shoving, jerking around. My dad thought it was a great, fun game to watch. My mom didn't like it at all, but we loved playing that game. And one time, my dad got a big dump truck load of gravel to redo our driveway and the areas around the barn. That was a great place to play King of the Hill on top of the pile of gravel. We came out bloody, scratched up, but it was so much fun, so much fun. There's something about if you could stand on top and kick everybody else away and survive, you were there. It's interesting how that dumb kids game, some of us as adults are still playing it, aren't we? We're going to scramble, we're going to push, we're going to shove, we're going to be deceitful, we're going to lack our integrity to make sure we are the ones on top, and we're going to stay on top no matter what, and our words can be very mean and spiteful to make sure we stay there. That is the opposite of the attitude of a Christ follower. That's the opposite of the words that God chose. This is what you should do and how we should work through it. In fact, the words of Jesus later in Luke chapter 14 says this. Would you read this aloud with me? Luke chapter 14, I believe it is. Well, there it is. Okay, would you read this with me? For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. So you lift up yourself, you're going to be humbled. It's interesting, the word humble and humiliated are closely related. Sometimes we lift ourselves up and it's not going to last. But if you just humble yourself, God is the one who's going to exalt us. God is the one who's going to lift us up. And I'd rather have his blessings and his approval than that of the world any day. Amen? There's a man named Samuel Morse. He invented the telegraph back in 1837. It was a significant accomplishment of his day. And when he did that, he received many awards. But you read about the history of Samuel Morse, you'll find there were some hard things happened in his life. He was just a humble person. And when he was asked about all those awards, I appreciate his response. He said this: I have made a valuable application of electricity, not because I was superior to other men, But solely because God, who meant for it for mankind, must reveal it to someone, and he was pleased to reveal it to me. Isn't that great? Saying, I just put these two things together, and God, who had it all together to begin with, was going to use somebody. He just happened to choose me. Isn't that better than saying, I invented, I'm important, I've accomplished more than you, look what I've done, and promote yourself and push yourself out of others? Just saying, God is going to use somebody. See, that's the attitude that Mary had. God's going to use somebody, and I'm so grateful that he's going to use me. It's the opposite of the attitude of Ted Turner when he said, if I only had a little humility, I would be perfect. Some of you know the name of Phyllis Diller. If you don't, still a good quote. She says, you know what keeps me humble? Mirrors. You know, the mirror in the morning before anybody sees you, that mirror. After a while, we're going to take communion. And when we take communion, part of that is we recognize God and his greatness and who he is. We recognize that Jesus came as Messiah. We recognize he took our guilt, our sin upon him. We also look in a mirror, a spiritual mirror. And when we do that, it takes a lot of humility. We don't look in this mirror of saying, look how good I am. Look how much I've accomplished. Look at this painted up, fixed up, disguised version of who I am. But look deep in your soul and say, who am I really? And it shouldn't be hard to be humble of heart and on your knees before God and saying, God, I'm a sinner, and I need you in my life. And it shouldn't be hard to be humble at all before God, but we've got to start humility before God, and then we live that out in front of others. Go back to verse number 50 of her song. She says, his mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. And at Christmas, we need to receive God's mercy. So we recognize his greatness. We recognize a humble state that we are all in. We also say, God, I need your mercy. I need your love. I need you to reach into my life, even though I don't deserve this. And I need the grace that you've come to offer to each one of us. And his answer is yes. It's saying, in my sin, I deserve hell, but you give me your mercy. And she says, and this is for all generations. It's for all generations. Because God loves all, and he brings us all together. Today, when we brag and promote ourselves and how good we are, look what we've accomplished, it says, no, that's not mean anything. We just need to come before God and say, I need your blessings. I need your direction. And today, if you're in that position where you say, I don't matter in anybody else's eyes. I've been knocked down. I've failed. I've messed up. I've done so wrong. It's just not there. No matter how hard I try, I can't get ahead at work. I can't accomplish. If you're in that place of just struggle, then it shouldn't be difficult for you just to turn to God and say, God, I need you. And surrender. But sometimes we still have a hard time just surrendering before God. So if that's you today that struggle in the eyes of the world, can you just turn to God and God will say, I love you and I accept you and I bring you in and I will meet the needs of your heart if we surrender to him. Now some of you in this room are the very highly accomplished. You've done great things. You've got all the degrees. You've got all the titles. You've succeeded. You've got all the stuff as far as the world's concerned. And you've got so many things you can be so grateful for. Can I just ask you to take all of that stuff, all the stuff that God has provided for you, the mind that you have, the abilities, and you surrender it all to God and say, God, this is all yours, myself obviously included. God, I give you everything because like Thomas Edison said, I can't do anything without you, and you're the one who's chosen to do this through me. Can you surrender that to him? Say, God, it all belongs to you. With no strings attached. So you're not saying, it's mine. You're saying, God, I give it all to you. And we do that with saying, God, I need your mercy. I need you in my life in every way. And verse 53 says, he has filled the hungry with good things and has sent the rich away empty. So when we're hungering for him, Matthew chapter 5, verse 6, again, the words of Jesus. Would you read this with me? Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. So in verse 53, he's saying, when you are hungry before me, when you're saying, God, I need you in my life. God, I need your mercy. God, I need your strength. He says, you're going to be filled. God's going to meet that need. But it comes through him and how he provides for us. See, God sees the nobodies, the forgotten, and that's the, one of those wonderful things about the Christmas story. So you don't have to impress God. You say, God, I need you, and I come before you, and I want to walk with you. What the world says is you're not important, you're not significant. The world says you're handicapped, you've got issues in your life. You come before God, and God says, I'm going to give you everything that is needed in your heart and your life today because of his mercy and because of his grace for each one of us. Now, verse 54 and 55, we finish this out. It says, he has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, even as he said to our forefathers, or to our fathers. So Mary's song wraps up, seems kind of abrupt, but she just ends and says, God, you remember. And at Christmas, we remember God's greatness, and we remember his promises. Remember, God keeps his promises. So God comes into our heart and our life, and he keeps his promises for Israel. He kept his promises to Abraham, and he keeps his promises today for each one of us. God is going to provide and take care of us. God's got those promises laid out for us. So Christmas, we remember God's promises. Now, those words of this promise is that the Messiah is going to come. The Messiah is going to come to through Abraham. The Messiah is going to come through all his generations, and this is the time he came about. But the Messiah has come, and the Messiah will come. It's important for us to recognize God still keeps his promises, and Jesus is returning, and Jesus is coming back. And we can live this life like, oh, someday it'll happen. But if you can turn that around and truly believe Jesus is returning, it changes how you live. It changes how you look on life. It changes saying today could be the day that Jesus returns. Today could be the day that I go see him. And when I live that way, I get things in perspective a little differently. My humility comes around and my need for grace and mercy comes about saying, Jesus, I need you. And remember, you keep your promises and you are coming for each one of us. Now, so we're going to do in a little bit. We're going to have a time of communion. And then we're going to have a time of response before God. And Brad's going to, and the whole team's going to come out, and they're going to lead us in a song. What I'd like for you to do is let's look at the words of this song, and so we can recognize God's presence in our life. First part of this, it says, amazing love that welcomes me, the kindness and mercy that was bought with blood. God, you're so good to me. The first part, this amazing love. God loves you. So God reaches into your heart. He provides for you this amazing love that God loves you. It was bought with a great price. But he did it because he loves each one of you. God does love us. In other words, I am blessed. I am called. I am healed. I am whole. I am saved in Jesus' name. Highly favored, anointed, filled with your power for your glory, for the glory of Jesus' name. Now I look at those words and I think, that sounds like who Mary is, or someone who's important. But according to God's word, that is us. Saying you are blessed by God. And God has anointed you. That means God has set you apart to serve and to honor him. You are favored by God. God has chosen you in your humble state. When you surrender to him, God says, yes, I choose to work through you. And God has a plan for your life. And God has a direction for your life to say, I need you to do this as part of the plan of life. And we serve him and to recognize God has chosen to work through each one of us. This great, powerful God of the universe. And he gives us the glory in Jesus' name. He gives us the presence of the Holy Spirit. And that is reason and humility to come before God and say, thank you, God, for using us and choosing. Another part of it says, and should this life bring suffering, Lord, I will remember what Calvary has bought for me, both now and forever. And God, you are so good to me. Some of you are at that place of suffering and difficulty and overwhelming grief and uncertainty of the future and those hard times. You wonder, God, where are you? And we stop and remember, no, Jesus died for me so I could have hope and presence. We look through the Bible. We look throughout history. It doesn't mean just because you're a follower of Jesus, God removes you from problems, and we've talked about that. We have the promise that God will be with us through those problems. We have this promise that forevermore we'll be with him. And there's hope in that because he is so good to each one of us. There's a passage in 1 Corinthians 11 that instructs us about communion time. It says, when we go to communion, we remember that on the night of Passover, Jesus was with his followers, and he took the bread, the unleavened bread, and he gave it to them, and he says, eat this, remember me. Remember his physical body, that he was present here on this earth. He's Messiah, God with us, come to earth. And then he took the cup, and this particular cup of the Passover was the cup of redemption. He says, you take this, I want you to drink it. When you drink of this, you think about my blood, which sounds kind of odd, but he says, think about my life. And think about how I've lived. Think about how I've loved. Think of the things that I've taught you, and that today we would know that he's living through us through the Holy Spirit. He says, you think about this every time we do it. So at communion time, we take that bread and we take the cup and we remember Jesus. Remember that he died on the cross for us. But the next verse, when instruction is given to us about communion, he says, don't take this in an unworthy manner. Because when you do, you're bringing judgment on yourself. But he says, when you take this bread, you take this cup, you take it in a manner that is worthy of one to receive this. And that worthy attitude means looking in the spiritual mirror, pulling back the cover up, and just being humble before God and say, God, I need you. So if you just take communion as a little refreshment break and say, Jesus, you're good, that's not correct, that's wrong. The Bible says you take it in complete humility before God. There's no room for any spiritual arrogance or pride at communion time. There's no reason for attitude to say, hey, God, you and I, we're good. We got this all good. Man, I'm a lot better than that guy sitting that row over there. I can't believe they're taking communion. How could they do that? If you're doing that is, you're going against Scripture. We come before God in complete humility. You say, God, I need you. And we have an attitude of gratitude saying, God, thank you so much that in my sin, you've come as your slave, as your servant, and you've given me hope, you've anointed me, you've set me aside, all of those things that you're part of my life, working in it. And we thank God for it. One more verse. It's a verse in Matthew chapter 11, the words of Jesus. Would you read this with me? It says, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. So here's our leader, our Messiah. He describes himself. He says, I am gentle and I am humble of heart. Now, if the God of the universe comes to us and he lives in humility as he demonstrates his grace, then shouldn't you and I? That today we just have a humble heart before God. We have a God who loves you so much. Father, we're grateful for this love and grace, your mercy, that you give us what we don't deserve. And Father, we're going to honor you in the way that you asked us to in just a minute. So as we take this bread and we take this cup, we remember the great price that you gave for each of us. Remember the death of Jesus, but we remember even more so the fact that he took all of our guilt and all of our shame and all of our punishment, and he paid it for us. Father, we celebrate his resurrection, his power over sin. Father, at Christmas, we're so grateful for your power and your gratefulness, your greatness, how you work in our lives, and for your mercy, and that you keep your promises. And Father, we come before you today humbly asking for your refreshment, your forgiveness, and your grace. So Father, at this time, I pray that you would bring, in some ways, conviction. Help us to see areas of our arrogance and pride. I pray that you give us refreshment and your grace, that you give us hope, that you give us direction, Father, I pray that your spirit move and we would be touched again with who you are for each one of us. It's in Jesus we pray. Amen. And so as the trays are passed, you're a follower of Jesus, we invite you to join us. And after a little bit of time, Brad's going to come out, begin leading us a song. While he's doing that, we invite you to come up. Friends will be down front. We'll pray with you. You can kneel and pray. But let's respond to God and before him now.